Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Good morning, Father.
We read in the second chapter of Job, and we read from verse 11 to verse 13. It says, when Job's three friends heard of all the adversity that had come upon him, each one came from his own place. Eliphaz, the Temanite, Bildad, the Shuhite, and Zophar, the Naamathite, for they had made an appointment together to come and mourn with him and to comfort him. And when they raised their eyes from afar and did not recognize him, they lifted their voices and wept. And each one tore his robe and sprinkled dust on his head toward heaven. So they sat down with him on the ground 7 days and 7 nights, and no one spoke a word to him, for they saw that his grief was very great. And we would trust the Lord will bless the reading of his word and or meditation upon it for Christ Jesus.
Amen.
The book of Job begins with an introduction to us of its main character, Job. Before his great loss, Job had a wonderful life. And then he had experienced the affliction. Then he had experienced the adversity. Before the affliction, before the adversity, the Bible tells us that he had a very great family. That any man who has a wife and 7 sons and 3 daughters, 10 children, had a great family, at least in terms of size. Chapter 1 and verse 2 tells us that he had a great family, was blessed with a wife, 7 sons, 3 daughters. That Job was the richest man in the East. And if you were to slowly read through the wealth of this man, his assets, even in our time, we will conclude that Job was indeed a very rich man. The man had 7,000 sheep and servants to tend them. That by itself made him rich. But that was not all. In addition to his 7,000 sheep, the Bible tells us that Job had 3,000 camels. 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels with servants to attend them.
500 yoke of oxen.
Servants to care for them, and it tells us again that he had 500 female donkeys with servants to care for them. The man was a rich man. By all estimates, it appears that Job also not only had a great family and riches, wealth, but he also was a healthy man. So here was a man with a great family, with great wealth, and with the health to enjoy that. He was indeed a blessed man. Then tragedy struck. Then he was afflicted by Satan. The Bible tells us that Satan killed Job's 10 children. Satan destroyed his 7,000 sheep with the servants that tended them, leaving only one to tell the message. His 3,000 camels were destroyed together with their servants, except for one. The 500 yoke of oxen, the 500 donkeys were all taken away. The man was afflicted. He experienced affliction. Then finally, the Bible tells us that the man lost his health. So that all that Job enjoyed, his family, his wealth, his health, he lost. But then the Bible tells us again in the passage that we read, chapter 2, that he experienced a visitation. Man who experienced the kind of adversity, the kind of affliction that Job experienced, needs good friends. The Bible tells us that he had three who visited him. They heard of Job's adversity, according to verse 11, the first part of verse 11, and they planned a visitation, and they came. The visitation was planned, the visitation was executed, they came to visit Job. Verse 12 tells us that these friends of Job demonstrated a spirit of compassion. They entered into his grief with him. So we are told that they saw Job from afar off. And what they saw was so troubling. Job's illness had so ravaged his body. His illness had so, as it were, changed his outward form that when Job's friends saw him, they did not recognize him. So that this experience of illness was not a common cold. His body was ravaged. The Bible tells us that they lifted up their voices and they wept because of what they saw. This was not the Job that they knew. And as an expression of their sadness and their compassion, the Bible tells us that they tore their robe and they sprinkled dust on their head toward heaven. They sat silently with Job for 7 days and 7 nights as they recognized the depth of his grief. Affliction, visitation, compassion. The story of Job reminds me of another story, the story of the human race. The human race has also experienced affliction. See, Job lost his children, and he lost his sheep, and he lost his oxen, lost his cattle, donkeys, but he did not lose his soul. If Job had lost his soul, that would have been his greatest loss. Is the affliction that has come upon us because of the fall. Sin has ravaged, sin has afflicted the human race, so that the affliction that we have experienced and do experience because of sin is not only temporal, not only related to time, but related to eternity as well. Want to suggest to us that there is an affliction that is greater than the loss of temporal things. If you were to have 10 children and lose them all, 7,000 sheep and lost them all, if you were to have lots of oxen and camels and donkeys and servants and you were to lose them all, it could not be compared to the loss of your soul. The greatest loss that any man could experience, any woman could experience, any boy and any girl, is the loss of the soul. It would take the work of the Holy Spirit to impress this truth upon the human mind. Because we naturally gravitate to physical things and often do not take an interest to that most valuable, invisible part of our existence, our soul. And we're trusting today that the Holy Spirit will do just that. That the Spirit of God will impress upon your mind that the most important loss, the greatest loss that you can ever experience, regardless of what you may earn or own and lose, if in the end you've lost your soul, that is your greatest loss. Lord Jesus Christ said, he asked the question, what shall it profit a man? What if you were to gain the whole world? The Lord Jesus is asking. What if you were to accumulate everything that this world has to offer and you were to be able to keep them, secure them safely, family, wealth, education, everything that this world has to offer, everything that Satan offered Jesus? What if you were to be able to accumulate all the stuff that Satan offered to the Lord Jesus Christ and you were to be able to hold on to them, keep them, secure them, and lose your soul? The Lord Jesus Christ asked this very pertinent question. What shall it profit a man if you were to gain the whole world and lose your soul? What shall a man give in exchange for his soul? So place all the wealth of this world on one side. The silver, the gold, all the wealth, the oil, everything this world has to offer. Place it on one side, and then place on the other side your soul. The Lord Jesus Christ is saying that it's worth giving up everything this world has to offer if in the process you save your soul. Because your soul is more valuable. So that if your soul is lost at the end of life, then you would have lost everything. And that would be an affliction, that would be an adversity of immeasurable proportions. It cannot be measured what it would mean to lose your soul at the end of life, coming to the end of life's little journey, and finding that perhaps you had a wonderful life, a life undisrupted, not disrupted that in the way that Job's life was disrupted, but you had a wonderful life. But in the end, leaving everything behind and having lost your soul, the Lord Jesus Christ says it does not make sense. What shall it profit you, O man? What shall it profit you, O woman? What shall it profit you, boy or girl, if you were to gain the whole world and lose your soul? That would be a great affliction. You know, we were born afflicted by sin, and sin is the reason why men lose their soul. Because we could not fix the sin problem. We cannot fix ourselves. We cannot deal successfully with the problem of sin. We need someone else to fix it. Like Job needed a visitation, we also need a visitation. Job, in his deep affliction, was visited by friends. We need a visitor. Not a visitor from the east like Job's friends. We needed a visitor from heaven. We needed not an ordinary visitor, but we needed a divine visitor. We needed a visitor who is Emmanuel, God with us. We needed a visitor to take care of our sin problem, who is both the Son of Man and the Son of God. God sent such a visitor. That visitor to the Jews, of course, is a stumbling block to the Greeks. Foolishness. Paul said to the Corinthians, we preach Christ, the wisdom of God and the power of God. That is the visitor we needed. John tells us, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made by Him, that's the Word, and without Him was not anything made that was made. And then he tells us in verse 14 that the Word, Jesus, was made flesh and dwelt among us. God sent a visitor. That visitor is His well-beloved Son. And so we sent Christ by highest heaven adored. Christ, the everlasting Lord, just on time. Behold Him come, offspring of a virgin's womb, veiled in flesh. The Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with man to dwell, Jesus or Emmanuel. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all He brings, risen with healings in His wings. Mild, He lays His glory by. Born, that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth. Born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. God saw us in our need and He sent His Son. We needed a visitor, not an ordinary visitor. We needed a visitor who is both Son of God and Son of Man, and God sent Him. God sending His Son in the form of human flesh. God dwelling among us, coming into the world to visit us. Jesus was God living in the midst of us. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. God gave His Son from heaven because we needed a divine visitor. Amen. And it may be foolishness to the Greeks, and it may be a stumbling block to the Jews, but for us, for God, is the wisdom of God and the power of God. Amen. So that there is affliction and there's visitation. But then there's compassion. And I want to add another word, substitution. Compassion, in the case of Job, Job's friends could offer compassion. The one thing they could not offer him was substitution. He must bear his pain. He must suffer the loss. They could sympathize. They could have compassion, but they could not take his place. He must bear his own pain. But when God sent His heavenly visitor, He came not only as one who had compassion, but He came as a substitute. In Jesus, we have both compassion and substitution. With Job's friends, we have compassion. With the Lord Jesus Christ, we have compassion and we have substitution. Our Emmanuel, our Lord Jesus, not only had compassion on us and came and dwelt among us, bearing our sins and bearing our burdens and our sorrows, as He dealt with our weaknesses and healing the sick and raising the dead and all that, but the Bible tells us that He took upon Him our sins. He took upon Himself our sins and bore the penalty for our sins. By the Lord, did the Lord Jesus Christ cry on Calvary, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? The reason why the Lord Jesus Christ cried that cry was because God, who could do all things, took our sins, the sins of the whole world, and placed it upon that divine visitor, who was both God and man. God laid our sins on Jesus, and in bearing our sins, bearing our load, God meted out His wrath upon His well-beloved Son. He afflicted Christ so that we may not be afflicted. In order to deliver us from our affliction, the Lord Jesus Christ must not only come from heaven and do mighty works, but He must come from heaven as a man and take upon Himself our sins and die on the cross, be buried and rise again from the dead, and be exalted at God's right hand. That's exactly what happened. We also received a visitation from heaven, God becoming a man. We also experienced a compassion from God and from Christ, but we experienced much more. We experienced substitution, as the Lord Jesus Christ took upon Him your sins and mine. So the songwriter says, in loving kindness, Jesus came, my soul in mercy to reclaim, and from the depths of sin and shame, through grace, He lifted me. He called me long before I heard, before my sinful heart was stirred. But when I took Him at His word, forgiven, He lifted me from sinking sand. He lifted me. With tender hand, he lifted me from shades of night to plains of light. Oh, praise his name. He lifted me. Said his brow was pierced with many a thorn, his hands by cruel nails were torn. When from my guilt and grief forlorn, in love he lifted me. Friends, all been afflicted by sin, and Jesus Christ has come. And so our question to you today is, have you been lifted? Has the Lord lifted you from your affliction? Has he freed you, delivered you from your affliction of sin? And we trust today. Perhaps today is the day that you will submit yourself to the Lord Jesus Christ. Today is the day perhaps when you would come to him and receive him, that heavenly visitor, the only one who could free you from sin's affliction. We trust that you'll come to him today, that you'll come to know him as your personal savior, and have that soul of yours for which he died, delivered, saved, and prepared for eternity. We trust that you'll come to him today for Christ Jesus.
Amen. There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till your work on earth is done. Jesus, my Redeemer, name above all names, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, oh, for sinners slain. Thank you, oh my Father, giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till your work on earth is done.
And leave.